Okay, good evening. Happy to be here. I'm taking the architect's perspective, and that's actually connected up with what Simon was saying. It's about social processes and architecture's framing and ordering social processes and sets the purposes for which technology solutions then apply. So society's purposes and aimed for congenial user experience, that's what we are about in terms of the architectural perspective. City is society, and that has been changing. There's been a radical historical shift from 50 years ago to now and into the future. And that has to do with technology as driver as well, in terms of the shift from Fordism, Fordist mass mechanical reproduction, stable over decades, starting in the 1920s all the way to the 70s, meant suburbanization, meant 9-to-5 routines, from everybody, homogenization of the population in terms of universal consumption standards. We're moving into a kind of different arena where all the people who used to be locked into assembly lines, whether they're bureaucratic or mechanical, and are set free to become creatives, to reprogram these robots which are now spinning out products, and they could be reprogrammed weekly, or services which are now uploaded onto apps daily, if you like, and ready for billions around the world. And that means we all converge into the city, and becoming this dynamic ecosystem of collaboration. So, and to generate that new level of prosperity and kind of the social cooperation is the prosperity engine, of course. City-wise, that means a kind of total transformation from this kind of industrial city to the post-Fordist network society city, and London is a key example here. This urban concentration and piling in and dynamism and complexity. And in terms of the individual buildings, be moving from this kind of simple routine where you 9-to-5 and you know where you are, to continuously evolving roaming space where you don't have a particular space, and where also we have intelligence and artificial intelligence in the furniture in the future. But also urbanism means when it embeds and transforms, it can be adaptive, it can be coherent and self-differentiating. And I believe in this kind of more creative destruction rather than healing, but at the same time, it is also continuous self-making and evolving. And this is some of our urban master plans, which are built on the idea of complexity dynamism and rejecting routine repetition, as well as this kind of random agglomeration we're seeing at the moment spontaneously happening. But what we like is, this is the first kind of smart city style economic cluster. Instead of having separation of workspaces from residential spaces and having fenced in car parked blocks, we have an urban fabric, densification, and then even connecting buildings on ground through pedestrian passages through all buildings, as well as on multiple layers in bridges across. So for me, the theme of the buildings being part of a fabric, a woven network, internally inter-aware with all the spaces, communicating through atria, and then from building to building through bridges, is the way we're looking at this. And this could also go into multiple layers, into the third dimension. So it's a three-dimensional weave we should get into, so that one layer on the ground is maybe no longer enough in the future. Hong Kong is an example where you had two layers already, but there could be more layers. And again, some of our buildings where we're opening up, rather than hiding everything floor against floor or even on the floor through a core, across levels, interaction. And then I looked at the ABB image of the office building. It was all separated cells, but we need to be inter-aware. We need to cooperate and communicate and be inter-visible to be part of thousands of people coming together, precisely co-locating, to cooperate. It means they need to run into each other, meet each other, and develop networks of communication and cooperation. These are the kind of visions of buildings we are offering and working on at the moment. A lot of them in Asia and China, where you have more scope for radical innovation and more dynamism of growth. This is one of the buildings recently finished in Macau. So this kind of exterior structure opens up that freedom of interior connecting throughout the building, and there you, the elevator becomes a navigation and a three-dimensional vertical street in which you can experience what's going on, participate, connect up, and also at the same time remain visibly connected with other buildings around in the urban weave. That's what my vision is, and I can imagine the exciting London cluster to have atria and bridges to be the next stage. We also make studies like this where we have public event spaces, not only in the roof, that's great, intermittent, to come down and meet and have again atria and these intermittent green and public spaces. We're doing also these kind of, on an urban scale, cluster. We're trying to find district figures, signatures, where multiple buildings cohere into something, configure in the real sense, rather than being in a random agglomeration. A few literally smart city branded projects around the world. We just won this in Moscow, the outskirts smart city. And again, the attempt to open up the block structure, have porosity, interaction. Some of these might become atria. And then also building up height, and you can see the terraces, the porosity, and this layeredness of a three-dimensional city, and at the same time trying to make it green, trying to make it harmonious and beautiful, letting water in, letting green in, and having residences coming through that. That's the beautiful site in Moscow. We won this, and we're doing technology campus in Xi'an for Tencent. And you'll see here, look at the number of Chinese projects now, where they're kind of, at the moment, the policy is to reject very high density and have more of a garden city, Stanford campus-like idea, but we're still having a layeredness and three-dimensional complexity in this. I think it's a mistake, perhaps, to spread out, but it's something we work with. But you can try to see, we're trying to have urbanity, layeredness, deep vistas and transparency in this. And of course, there's technology is presumed to be kind of dominant in this technology company campus. Wuhan, these are city expansions which are also premised on that new wave of service and R&D and finance and marketing based knowledge economy, which China is shifting away from. And we already, of course, fully within from the manufacturing into R&D, a project for Wuhan. We were thinking high density. We didn't get it because we are in this kind of low density paradigm. So we didn't win this one, but we won this one in Chengdu. This is actually called Unicorn. This is about a startup culture and Unicorn, the one in a million winning startups, which are meant to be kind of incubated in this space. And again, an attempt to have green gardens, campus feeling, but higher density than you have at Stanford campus. And again, in Qinghongdao, an hour and a half train ride from Beijing, and you can see again this kind of idea of a green city with a lot of in-between spaces and types of residences, co-living, co-working, an interesting fabric. This kind of paradigm is happening. And it's lovely, but maybe not dense enough. This is Chongqing. It's on the outskirts. It looks very, very village-like, but urbanism is just the kind of, just out of the frame, hitting at it. But this piece of land, we again, is this kind of idea of a campus, very organic, very layered, with all mixed uses coming in. This is actually lightweight manufacturing, offices as well, of course, research development, universities, as well as residences, and a very high level of technology and investment. I just throw this in between, this kind of campus. We just won a competition for Hong Kong University campus. Similar concepts. And you can see the idea of making variety, of making it landscape-like, making it porous, open, interconnected, using the three-dimensionality to overlook and have elevational transparency in these, and the whole series, of course, of communication, because this is not where you come in and sit 9 to 5 on your desk. This is where you roam around in the city, making connections, meeting. So there needs to be a lot of pedestrian, cycling, and all these kind of ways of communicating across in this space. And just, you could look at this building which you just finished. It's a research and development campus in Riyadh, as a fragment of that larger texture. And you can see here already that if you couldn't just keep repeating this, there needs to be a lot of variety and differentiation, but I said at the same time, coherency and connectedness between the different aspects. And you see also the porosity and openness of this continuously flowing field with a lot of outdoor spaces, atria, in different kinds of spaces, meeting spaces, libraries, courtyards. This is a kind of working texture for this kind of dynamic complex interaction scenario we're trying to get at. But I think rather than having these kind of greenfield conditions campus, I think we should again look at the big metropolis as the site for the next wave of prosperous network society and infused with technology. So this is Manhattan, obviously, and there's an attempt of bringing the green perhaps into here and making that happen. So of course, co-working, there's co-working revolution is very enormous, and that means that dynamism, where you don't know who's coming, you're booking your table online, it's also happening in China. So we've been working for Google, or been made some sketches for them, because they are sitting here, and I think the New York campus in the end is a better version than the Palo Alto, because you're right in the center of Manhattan, and they're building up a whole technology cluster there. Some of these sketches we've created. And I just want to end with a few images of work we're doing. I've been doing with students at the ADRL, where we're looking at Manhattan and looking at Google incubator space. And you can see what we're trying to do here is something very porous, very open, very integrated, very urban, with interior urbanism, if you like, coming through. So there's a complex internal landscape, simultaneity, layeredness, many different companies interacting, intersecting, working together. And we start seeing these simulations. This is actually agent-based parametric semiology. We're actually doing and building for the first time crowds which are differentiated crowds, which are sensitive to sociologically and semiologically encoded domains and subdomains, each embedding with their and triggering protocols of behavior. So each agent has multiple stacks of behavioral protocols which are triggered when they entering a particular spaces and reconfigure. So we have three or four actually models of that. And you can see this kind of openness, the porosity, yet you have intimacy and conspicuous domain making without walls in an open territory. And the next level of this is that a lot of these furnishings are actually themselves AI agents with intelligence, with behaviors, with spontaneous behaviors and learning capacities. I don't have these animations here, but that's the next layer on a level of what we're working on. But the main point here is actually the crowd simulations, and I'll come to that, a third one of these projects. These are the vistas and visions, and here some of this crowd simulation is happening. So these are agents which are autonomously acting and moving. They have rule sets, decision trees, so they have a decision structure and a utility function which guides them and allows them to navigate. And some of the spaces then light up or open and close. And you can see wherever you are, you have you're surrounded by multiple actors and agents, simultaneous ongoings which you are aware of. And yet you have at the same time defined spaces, intimate conditions, a kind of temporary closure of a realm, of a unity, of interaction, of a social situation, and then you move from one to the other in that field of simultaneity. And I imagine that to be moving from building to building and be kind of choreographed and, as you said, managed through the building itself, the way its facade acts, the way furniture moves, partitions open, light shifts and changes, inviting people in. And that's the next level of research we're now bringing. We can bring that all into the same game engine, the human actors, as well as the autonomous architectural actors. So that's the research project, agent-based parametric semiology, a kind of new level of smartness with respect to the architect smartness. We are in charge of the social functionality and then the technical functionality, which takes care of the physical soundness, safeness, temperature, etc., is engineering business. I think I leave you with that image. Thank you.